Blog Talk Radio.
Peace. Good day, ladies and gentlemen, brothers and sisters, friends and foes. Welcome to another edition. I am your host. And let's get down to business. To the Jew first. Before I delve deep into this subject, allow me to give you the biblical salutations of peace in the languages of Scripture. We say it in the Amharic language by saying salam. We say it in the Arabic language by saying salam. And we say it in the Hebrew Aramaic by saying shalom. That simply means peace. I wish peace to be upon every single person living. With that said, this message here, I want to be able, or I will, when I'm done, be able to prove, to show and prove, the craftiness of biblical and Quranic writers and the tricks that they have played. I want to reveal some of them. So to my Christian brothers and sisters, I'm going to say some things that will probably, most likely, 9 times out of 10, is going to upset you. But I want you to hear this all the way through, because this is not designed to offend you. But sometimes the truth offends. It does. Before you could cut the pie, and if you're using a knife, you got the whole roundness of the pie. In order to get your slice, you're going to have to cut. So, in order to get your slice of truth, you're going to have to let me cut your slice. Now, to the Jews. Now, that was for saying that. That was to my Christians and Catholics. Unless they have updated the maps, you know they like to move the goalposts. But in actuality, there is no city of Nazareth on any maps until the 4th century AD. And they told you that Jesus was born between 3 and 6 BC. He was born before Christ. 6 years before Christ. It's just saying that's what BC means, right? Or some will say before the common era. However, he says that, we'll just leave it like that. I want one more, you know what? I'm going to give you one more secret. And I want you to do some homework in the book of 1 Kings. I want you to look back in there. And sometimes you can't give everybody the answers. I want you to look back and see. I want you to look in the genealogy of Jesus. And there's a king that was the son of Josiah. I'm not going to tell you the name of that king. But that king was so wicked that it has it on the lips of the prophets that that king and his bloodline after him will never be successful or should rule on the throne for Israel. If you're going to say that there were some people thousands of years ago by the name of Israel. Yeah. If you're using it like that, right? So Jesus is disqualified because he has this particular king in his bloodline. He's automatically disqualified from being a Christ, from being a Messiah. I don't give a flying dog dung what's written in the Bible and what's written in the Quran. I don't care what they have written. They're lying. I want you to understand that they are lying. It is not true. It's historically inaccurate. It's scripturally impossible. Now, European Jews, once their two founders of the religion of Judaism, after the Crusades, around the 1080s, they began to write. Two of their main writers, which comes out to be the founders of Judaism, they go under the acronyms. One of those persons, the main one, his name is Rabbi Shlomo Vayeshek, or Solomon Bar Isaac. And his acronym is Rashi. And you can go into the Google search engine and you can type in Rashi and begin to understand about Rashi. Rashi is spelled R-A-S-H-I, right? Now, the second one I need you to research, his name is Rambam. That's his acronym. His real name and title is Rabbi Moses Maimonides. Acronym is Rambam. R-A-M-B-A-M. Very two important religious figures. You're going to see why they are important. They were Egyptologists. If you really understand Solomon, not nobody ancient, we're talking about Solomon Bar Isaac and the Jerusalem temple was named after him during that time. Yes, he had a lot of students, and a lot of his students, if you just, as you're Googling Rashi, you just Google down a little bit, you'll see some of his students. Some of his students is Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, Israel, or Yisrael, and so on. All these Yiddish names, Yiddish and what they call Hebrew names, right? And these are the people that really makes up the early peoples of Israel. And they, what they have done is that they attempted a fraud on history. It's because a little later after that, as they had their writings and they, you know, began to write certain stuff down, you know, there was you know, stuff to write on back then, you know, in Europe, in the Germany area. But there was no people back then named Jews. Now, in order to know what the Jews called themselves before the letter J was invented in 1630, that's some more homework that you need to do. But you have to understand something. Without pronounced upon them laws of reciprocity, you know, good and bad, you know, blessings and curses, which you can also find those in Leviticus 26 and Deuteronomy 28. Very, very important for you to remember that. Not a people on this planet that fit the descriptions of what is supposed to happen to those peoples that disrespect or go against or deviate from God's instructions. Those people will go into a worldwide captivity. Then you had this prophet named Yeshayahu. Then he started talking to them about how they will go into captivity. And they did go into captivity, into a world captivity, where then these people were, a lot of them would end up into an area called the North Country, if you know your scriptures. And in that North Country, those people, more than their other kith and kin that is in captivity in different parts of the world, denigrated based on their skin color, to hold them in place because they deviated against God's instructions. So therefore, they're under these punishments. And the reason why they're under these punishments is because these people made a certain covenant with this God. And because they made that covenant, that means then that as long as they have descendants on the earth, they're still under that contract until they reverse the curses. And the only way to reverse the curse of reciprocity or the effects of the negative aspects of the laws of reciprocity, they would have to turn the negatives into a positive by going into a system of re-education and then be able to apply those laws, those commandments, right? To their very lives, and they could become the people that they were chosen to be, and then they ought to do their job. And what did they sign up to do? They signed up to be reformers. Their job was not that other messengers will be sent of different ethnicities. Hell no. From this particular group of peoples, that they will be sent out into all nations, and they would have to reform the nations into being one global community under one culture, under one God, and they shall be one people, even though they have various languages and so on and so forth. The languages don't even matter, as long as they do the same thing. This is what they was chosen to do. Now, going back to Rashi and Rambam, they made up this religion called Judaism, or the Way of the Barons. And at first, it was a rich religion. Then, they started letting average people in. You know, because they needed to grow a following. Then once they grow that following, then they start making mandates and so on and so forth. You know, little rules in their religion, how people would have to pay, you know, and be a part of that association. So then you start having rights to that religion. You know, R-I-T-E-S. You have rights, not rights, but rights. Right? Meaning, it's a prescription in order to do this particular religion, in order to live this way. This is why Judaism, Christianity, and Islam is the way that it is. Now, as they making this religion, was there the Christian way of doing things? Yes, it was. But it wasn't as, let's say, carefully organized. It was more random. People picked up on traditions and customs and so on and so forth. You know what I mean? But one thing had happened. Once when you had the founding of Judaism and you had the Christian crusades and all that kind of stuff like that, right? Islam wasn't developed yet. So that came later on. And I know that most people would say, well, no. Islam has been here since the time of Prophet Muhammad. No one knows anything about no Muhammad until at least 200 years after they said that this man lived. Did you know that? Did you know that? No, you didn't. Everything that was created about Muhammad wasn't done in Mecca and Medina. No, this is a part of an older story, right? And guess what? Everybody that wrote about Muhammad, why does the hadith and the sayings and so on and so forth, the biography of Muhammad, comes out of Baghdad? Why doesn't it come out of Mecca? You gotta answer this. Because, hell, you don't even have Mecca on any trade routes until the 900s AD. Y'all in trouble. Because now you're going to have to justify your religion. You're going to have those artifacts. You're going to have those tombs with bones in them. You're going to have the maps to justify, you know, like how y'all did trade and so on and so forth. Since Mecca is supposed to be like heaven on earth, this is supposed to be the original place where Adam and Eve landed when they were supposedly kicked out of heaven. See? And they was kicked down to Mecca? But nobody knows about this Mecca until 900 AD? We all should have a problem with this. Now, let's just throw in that there. Yes, we understand about Christianity and the worship of Serapis and how during the 31st dynasty of Egypt, but ushering that in, you have to understand about the Arabs. They didn't have religion. They was just nomads. They had little villages and so on and so forth, right? You know, in certain areas. I'm talking about during the times of the ancient Egyptians. But the ancient Egyptians had gold, they had papyrus, they had ink, and they had a wealth of inventions wanted to take hold of. The Egyptians was not sharing. And because of that, this started other groups of people that say, wait a minute, we need to be in on this too. If they won't let us in, we're going to have to overthrow them. We're going to have to take from them. And so when this started to happen, you got people that was coming out of the what you call the upper Middle East, where you got Russia, you got Asia, then they connect to the Middle East and start coming down like Iraq and Iran and all that kind of stuff. Those always have been, you know, a mixed breeded people. So we call those Eurasians. We don't say Asiatic because that term Asiatic was invented by a German anthropologist in the 1600s. So you can't use Asiatic and purport that back in time. You can't do that. I'm not going to let you do that. You got to understand when stuff, everything has its etymological origin. If you can't type in the dictionary of etymology and find out the origins of a word, they don't even have a date there, they're trying to deceive you. Just like the word Israel. They do not have a date for Israel. They can always just refer you back into the Bible. But then you would have to understand when the Bible was invented. The Bible was invented after the invention of the printing press of Johann Gutenberg. You got to understand that. Without that, you ain't got no damn Bible. You ain't got no Bible. Now, do you got scriptures where it says, thus saith the Lord, and then we have prophets? Yes. But then now you're going to have to go through some of the oldest people that's on the planet in order to get thus saith the Lord. Because that only comes through one ethnic group of people, and that's the Ethiopians. Even when you're talking about prophets that was in Egypt, what's their ethnic origin? Even the Egyptians go back down up into the Nubians, into the Ethiopians. All of them are the same people. It's just geographical. And then they named themselves after different territories and so forth. These are all Nile Valley Africans. You were talking about the Nilotic people. Now, what the Jew was able to do when he seized the printing press by Johannes Gutenberg, because he owed them money, the first thing that they started printing was a Bible. The first Bible that was in print. Some people call it the Gutenberg Bible. It had 42 lines of script. There were no Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. There wasn't no Book of Malachi, the book of Exodus, and all that. No. They have 42 lines of script. That was the first Bible. So you're in the neighborhood of the 14, you're in the 1400s, you know what I mean?
Okay.
Now, 43 lines, right? Which is interesting, because you had the 42 laws of Maya, but really it's more than 42 laws, it's just that was a sum total for that ancient Egyptian time period before Akhenaten. Because it was Akhenaten by his finger that he wrote 10 for his brother, gave them to them, so then he could distribute this among the Habarus, which is the original, or what they call the original Hebrews. But there was no Jews and there was no Israelites in ancient times. And I know some people would say, no, Israel only means Isis, Ra, El. No, stop that bullshit. Stop that bullshit. No, they just did not exist. They just did not exist. Where's the tombs or any bones with them? They said that it was over 1.2 million Israelites that exited out of Egypt. You know what that would do to an economy? That would crash that economy. But that country didn't have this great economy crash, did it? In history? No, it didn't. So what the hell are we talking about? You're talking about myth. You're talking about some story that somebody has invented. You're talking about then they begin to write. And when they begin to write, because for the Western Europeans, they figured that they would get the jump on the world. Now, the only other people that had some type of printed material was the Far East Asians, and they wasn't sharing their press with the Europeans. They wasn't sharing that with us. No. So here we have these scriptures. Then you start having, you know, thicker Bibles being printed. Then you had this one guy. He came up. His name was. After now, then you start getting, you know, when the Jews started getting their stuff together with their printing press and then sending more stuff to the print. Then they use some of the writings of Rashid and Rambam. And that gets incorporated inside the Bible, and all it gets is a narrative. It's just a narrative tale, an allegorical tale. Then after years and years and decades and a few hundred years, then they started adding numerology in there, you know, and adding other fluff like astrology and symbolisms and parables and with other religious lessons and psalms and other things like that. And all of you, now mind you, when you go back to the most historical of any biblical text, they're not going to show you the facsimiles that they really have copied these from, and so on and so forth. But if you can, I was able to see some of the oldest manuscripts, some of the oldest stuff that existed that had to be transferred from the papyrus onto skin so they can last longer, because on the papyrus they don't last that long once when they start getting out into the air and they deteriorate and stuff like that. But when you're looking at some of those original documents, you'll always say, you might can find some and so on and so forth, right? And they would have that Egyptian Unk at the top of them. You're going to find that on those more older scripts. Oh yeah. Go into the Ethiopian, you'll find the same thing. Go into and look at their older scripts, then you're going to find out, wow, the Ethiopians have a text. Yeah, they have a text, and it's different from your standard English biblical text. That right there should make you right now go and buy an Ethiopian version in Amharic. Or you might find it in Ge'ez. Or some people would say G-E-E-Z. Ge'ez. You might find it in Ge'ez or Ge'ez, as some people would say. Very, very important that you know this. Excuse me. Now, let's go on. We got to move quickly. Now, later on, once they get the book, and then they started adding more to it, then they made their Old Testament. First they made their Torah, then they made their Old Testament. Then when you start making this Old Testament, now you got foundation, right? You got the foundation. Now you done added, made this whole allegorical story, right? You know, beginning from Father Abraham, and he was of the righteous, and so on and so forth. Then you had Isaac, and then Abraham having the two sons with the two covenants. See, because then that's going to be later on dedicated to another people, right? You got Isaac's people, and you know, which later on became Israel, or Jacob's people. Then you got you got his other son, you know, from Isaac, which is Ishmael, right? Or from Abraham, you know, you got Ishmael. And then that later on would be designated for the Arab peoples, you see. Now watch this. History, mainly from the 1550s BCE up until the time of Akhenaten, which is around 1350 BCE, and the Jew begins to write. And when they begin to write, right, they're writing to, they're looking at the history of it and then writing as they go, as if they're going to be writing about themselves. What are they doing? They're adding themselves in history. How do you add yourself in history? You invent people, places, times, events. Then you incorporate narrative stories. You're using stories of other peoples. Majority of the stories of other peoples. All you're doing is changing names. You might add in some dress. You might add in some cuisine. Oh, they was eating some bread and butter. You might say that they was drinking some milk. And you know, you add stuff in it. Why? Because that makes the story seem real. And also, it's adding in some of them, the peoples, you know, who they write about. It add their customs in there. Once you start adding, you know, customs and what people do on an everyday basis, then it becomes them. So then when somebody is reading the text, they can't help but to see these people. So that's why when you read the Bible, don't tell me you see no black Jews, no black Israelites. Hell no, you see that European Jew. That's why when you reading the Quran, you only can envision it in the skin texture of the Arab people. You can't look at that and see black people or Africans or melanated people. That's not possible. Why? Because they're in control over the book. And when they're in control over the book, they say what God says. You don't have a goddamn thing to do with that. They have edited you out. They have taken history that belongs to you and incorporated inside of the Bible and the Quran, and they put their ethnicity upon it. They didn't do it once. They did it three times. They did it for a book, Old and New Testament, for the European Christian. And they did it for the European Jew. And then when they write their Quran, then it's for the Eurasian Arab. You are out of gas as melanated people. You got to understand this. This is why you ain't got no world power. Because while your people was dealing with colonializations and slaveries in different parts of the world, these peoples wrote books and then they established histories. And then as they're going back, only thing they're doing is rewriting and then adding themselves to the text. This is why you can look back in ancient history and talk about, oh, well, Josephus, there wasn't no goddamn Josephus. Or Josephone. How the hell do you got that? And the letter J wasn't invented until 1630. Get your ass up out of here with that. There's a whole bunch of stuff. If you just purported back in time, it's disqualified. So where was the damn Jews at when that wrote the Septuagint for Alexander the Great? What, no damn Jews? You can't purport Jews back in ancient times. You can't really purport Muslims back in ancient times. Hell, even Islam means those that agree. Agree to what? To the mandate of the barbarous Arabs that was coming into different areas. It was they way or the sword. So if you agreed with this, this is why it says, it's why I mean submission to the will of God. You got to go back to the original code of what that meant. So you don't know about that. You don't do digging. You don't go and try to find out the root and source to different things. Just like a lot of you, you know, are purporting to be Christians. And still is ignorant of the fact that the world's first Christians worshiped a god called Serapis. And Serapis was the god that was established after Alexander, right? Remember I told... For the first time in human history, he had the Egyptians to build him a light tower. And then that light tower means that this is a light world right now. And then what they did was then have this monolithic statue of Isis, arms of Isis, and they put on the shores of Alexandria, right? The city of Alexandria. So those coming on the Mediterranean, they could see it far and wide. And you know what they had? They had this statue of Isis, because everybody in the world knew what it was. And in her arm, she had a baby, and in her arms it was baby Serapis. Serapis Christa. And that was the god that was worshipped or was forced to be worshipped upon the ancient Egyptians once when the Macedonian Greeks came in, and then they became the Coptic Christians, the Coptic Egyptians. They became those people. They ruled over us. They became the last pharaohs. And they took all of the power and all of the wealth and everything that was in Egypt. They took it all out, and then they packed it up, and then they moved into Europe. And so that's how Europe became the center of power. You better listen to what I'm saying. And you haven't had power ever since. And that was the beginning of racism and white supremacy right there. Why? Because it was Egyptians, artisans that created, and then sculptors that created Serapis. Oh yeah, there was the ancient Egyptians, the Coptic Egyptians, right? That wrote the doctrine of salvation, right? So, you know, to worship it and give all kinds of, you know, rites and what do you call those rituals and so on and so forth, right? For Serapis. They used the ancient Egyptians. Why? Because they was good at creating that, those kind of things. They said, no, you're going to make something similar to what you already had. And then we're going to destroy all the other gods. And then Serapis will be the only god, the one god for us that everybody should worship. And then after that time, right? Then I'm going to fast forward, right? This is really important because I don't want it to cut off. So what happens is that Serapis was never real. Serapis, when you look at Serapis, right, you're going to find elements of Alexander the Great. You're going to find elements, you're going to find elements of Ptolemy Soltar the First, right? Then you're going to find elements of Jupiter, and you're going to find elements of Zeus, especially with the hair and that kind of stuff like that. So Serapis Christus later on became Iesus Christos. When you start going into the Latin, and then, you know, and then they incorporating that into the English. And then once when they made the English Bibles after the letter J was invented in 1630, then that's how you come up with a Jesus Christ. So when I tell you that there was no man born 2,000 years ago by the name of Jesus Christ, see, I can give you the history and everything about Serapis that would back that up, so that you could just Google right now, and then you could even go to museums, and then you could see statues of Serapis Christ. But you ain't got no tombs or any bones for any biblical account. Now you gotta ask yourself, why? Why do you have this stuff of all these other ancient people, but then you don't have this? Why do you have a whole new people that was invented called the Negro, and then you got the disappearance of the ancient Egyptian people and many of the Nubians and many of the Ethiopians? They seem to have disappeared, and the Hebrews of Habaru is connected in that group of those Egyptians and Ethiopians that disappeared. Now, you go up into Nahum 3:9, and it says that the Egyptians and Ethiopians had a power that was boundless and connected with the divine. How we fail from being connected with the divine is that we became culturally confused at the time when they coronated Alexander the Great. And when they coronated Alexander the Great, what does that mean when you coronate? That means that you inaugurate this person as Pharaoh. And one of the titles for Pharaoh not only was the son of God, right? Sarah. A Sarai, right? But also, you know, they called him Master of the Universe. They gave him all the lofty titles. They bestowed all of it upon him for all intents and purposes in order to hold off those Eurasian peoples, because Alexander had fought those peoples already. So they would mess with Alexander. When they see the Macedonian Greeks coming to them, and the vastness of the European army, right, that was connected with Alexander, right? That would make them just, hey, they would go back to their homeland and say, oh, no, we don't want no more smoke with Alexander. So that's why the Egyptians went to them. They said, no, we need protection. So Alexander said, you're only going to find it in a very few books. Okay? One book that you should read is The Splendor That Was Egypt by Margaret Murray. Oh my God, that is a powerhouse right there. You need to read that. Okay, well, yeah. Now. Let me hurry up. So making this Jesus Christ, right? So they seized all the literature that they could get. They went throughout all the Middle East. They went throughout all Egypt. They tried to confiscate some things from the Ethiopians from the Nubians and so on and so forth, right? All kinds of wars like that was fought. But in order to hold them back, Alexander had to be coordinated. They made this agreement. And so with the Egyptians, they never, ever, the only time when they had somebody leopard skin ruling, you know, over certain parts of Egypt was when they did scopes, you know, and when they were ruling. And some people would like to refer them to as the ancient ancestors of the European Jews. I mean, I've looked at the history of it, and it's still a lot of mythos out there and so on and so forth. So, but as it stands right now, you know, I could see the connection. I could see the connection. So I'm not in denial of that. You know what I mean? I'm not in denial at all. That's fine. So they was called Hyksos, and they had a city in Egypt. On the northern tip, it was called Avaris. They was not black people. They was, you know, nomadic people. And they was very light-skinned in texture based on the reliefs that they left of themselves. And then if you look at them, you could see the resemblance to these Europeans. I ain't got no problem with that. Now, the making of Serapis, and they forced this image on the Egyptians, and it took about almost 1,000 years to make the Egyptians bow down to them. In the meantime of that, then you get the Council of Ephesus, you got the Council of Nicaea, and all this kind of stuff like that. Now, at the Council of Nicaea, most people is not looking at the minutes of the meetings and really what they're trying to do. What they're trying to do is give human spirit to a statue. Meaning, if a statue is of a real person that existed, like Pharaoh, an important person, right? It had to be real. It had to be a real person. So they was trying to give the spirit of the Holy Father unto this grotesque statue of the so-called Son. So who birthed the Son? The Son is supposedly be birthed by Osiris. All in the mythos, you know what I mean? This is all mythos, right? Because all the pharaohs of Egypt, right? They, you know, supposedly through their chronology, right? Trace history, right? All the way back to Heru or Horus, and Horus being the son of Osiris. So that's how they all are, Sarah or the son of God, right? And as years went on, they took titles like Lord of the World or Master of the Universe, Son of God, the Koresh in Egyptian, it's the ancient Egyptian, right? So the Koresh became the Christos in the Greek, you see. And so Messiah became Messiah. You know, first it was like Mashiach, right? And then into Messiah. But the original was Messiah, meaning it was the mess. You know, it was like the fat of an alligator, right? It was melted upon his head, and then he was anointed and so on and so forth, right? Which only was the Pharaoh. You got to understand this. You know, your ruler over the country back then before the Greeks and the Arabs and the Romans became the ruler over Egypt, right? Your Pharaoh was all things into one. He was your prophet. He was your king. He was your high priest. He was your Messiah. He was your Christ. Matter of fact, he was the impersonation of God on earth for all human beings. That's how important Pharaoh was at that time. Going to have this schism in there where it depicts Moses as God said, Moses, put your hand in your bosom. So he put his hand, you know, inside of his clothes, and then he said, now pull it out again. And then he said his arm turned leprous, white as snow. Then he said, now put your hand back into your bosom again. He put it back into his cloak, and then he pulled it out again. And then it says, now it was changed back to its other skin. So two types of skins. So what happens here? What am I saying to you here? That from Moses, right? That the people of God was going to turn leprous. And once when truth gets revealed, but at first it has to be covered up. The covering up is their histories. Then he said, pull your hand out for the second time, right? Then it said it turned back to a second, you know, to its other skin. Now that other skin, now that's me teaching you right now of what they did, so then things could go to the way that it was. To the Jew first, then to the Gentile. How did they pull this off and leave out all Hemetic people? Then you get inside of a certain Bible concordance that start with a Z. I'm going to say, I don't know. I forgot the name of this Bible concordance. But anyway, it gives the table of nations in there, right? It talks about Shem, Japheth, and Ham. But on Ham, it says that Ham is the progenitor of all dark peoples, excluding the Negro. Oh, hold on, right? They are using a Bible concordance to keep you ignorant. I know Hebrew Israelites, they said we are not of Ham, even though they're really under the whole chronology of dark people. They said, but this is not, you know, the Negro is not of Ham. Why wouldn't he be of Ham if he has DNA that's of Ham? If he has skin that's of Ham? If he has phenotypes that is of Ham? Ham is all made up anyway. We are Nilotic people. We are people that originate on the banks of the Nile. This is why it says in the papyrus of Ani, we begin at the beginning of the Nile, where the god Hapi dwells at the foot of the mountain of the moon. So if we begin in along the Nile, see, that's civilization. You can't say civilization begins at Mecca. How can you say that when Mecca on the ancient maps is called Arabia Desertica? You know what that means? All desert, no water. Water has to be poured in. So even when the Muslims is doing their Hajj, and then they go to the Zamzam well, right? And everybody say, "Woo, this water tastes good." How did they was able to pour that water in? Oh, you think it's a miracle? Think again. The Europeans already been over there working with the Arab in order to make these basins so that people can wash and people can drink of that water. It's no miracle. That's being ported in from the local sea. They fooled you. They always is tricking y'all and getting y'all to believe in their nonsense. Oh, it's miracle water. See, we right here in the middle of the desert. That ought to tell you something. That ain't the beginning or origins of civilization. You know, in order to have civilization, you need water. Without water, you get no vegetables, right? You get no animals. You get no plant life. And without no plant life, you have no peoples. And without no peoples, you have no history there. There's no civilization. And if there's no civilization, yeah, there's no history. You see? That's how you discount that out. That's right there. You need water. Water means life. Even on the banks of the Nile, you had the papyrus plant was created. And from papyrus, you get the papyri. And from the papyri, you get papyrus. And therefore, then you begin to write. And even in Egypt, you had the invention of ink. So these was the first literate peoples on earth. This is why you go back to Count Bounty, and then he said, these are the people that gave us arts and sciences and our language. These are the people that we hold in chains. How did they turn to be evil against us? Because Egypt wouldn't share the power. So once when Alexander got the power, he's now going to share it with people that is European and Eurasian. And that's exactly what happened. He shared it with those that was European and Eurasian. Well, how y'all don't see this? This is why the African and Hispanic countries, right, in North Central South America and in Africa, right, they ain't got no weapons of mass destruction. They got no intercontinental ballistic missiles. They can't make war with anybody, but the Europeans do, but the Arabs do, and the Upper East Indians do, right? The more northern ones that connect to like Afghanistan, right, and those that's in the Far East. See, but when you're going through those societies, so on and so forth, right? All the dark peoples is on the bottom of their civilization. They want the world to always remember that the dark, melanated peoples and what they did, and they denigrated them, so now they're going to keep them denigrated. Now, in my clothes, how does we get this into the Bible? When the Jew, that white Jew, right? He is posing himself as being these people, right? All along, right? So there's a true people and a false people. You can't be the true Jew. The true Jew is the true Jew. People saying that. You know what I mean? Because that means that you got to adopt somebody else's stuff. You can't adopt nobody else's stuff. Otherwise, you become like them. You got to understand this. When you adopt the Arab stuff, you become like them. You become Arabized just like them. Why? Because that's a part of their culture. This is how they was able to have domination in Africa and in other dark nations, because of their religion, and their religion is tied into their culture. You gotta understand that this is all politics, this is economics, this is cultures, this is their history and so on. But this doesn't belong to you. This is why when you take Christianity as it is, it will make you into an Anglo-Saxon, or it will make you into an Englishman, a black Englishman, right? A black European. You know, you can't take what belongs to you. No, you need that which comes from your own people. I've been trying to connect you with Ethiopia. Why? Because we got everything that supersedes everybody else. Get your ass down there up in Ethiopia and start to learn and start to connect with your people. You don't need these Western Europeans' religions of Christianity, Islam, and Judaism. You got the best stuff down up in Ethiopia. You got the source to Islam, Christianity, and Judaism right down in Ethiopia. You got the best cuisine down there. You get everything down there. Why are you still trying to be like these people? No, give up their language. Give up their language. Go back down and get your own, because it's sitting there waiting for you to attach to. Now, then you get into, you know, they started to describe the Son of Man and how he looks and so on and so forth in the Old Testament. He looks black, don't he? Yep. Then you go into the book of Revelation. Then they start saying that, oh, yeah. You know, there's some that says they are Jews and who are not, I'll make other synagogues of Satan, but I know your poverty. Oh, so the ones that is not in synagogues, but they claim to have the same practices of the European Jews, they are in poverty. Look at that. The other ones are rich. Is the white Jew right now, right? And I don't like to play these color games or anything like that, so this is no game. I'm just pointing out the truth. Is they on top? Yes or no? You know they're on top. So they are in control of all media, pretty much, isn't it? Right? They're doctors, they're lawyers, and they're all in the entertainment field and so on and so forth. They have a power over media, over law, over medicine, over entertainment and so on and so forth. Can no one deny the European Jews' influence on modern civilization? Now you get around John 8:32. And then Jesus is talking to them. You notice I didn't say Yeshua, but Jesus is talking to them. He says, and you will be my disciples indeed, and you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. And so the Jews get to laughing at him. It says Jews right there, because you had the Pharisees, the Sadducees, you know, and the other groups and so on and so forth. And so it gives you this mental depiction. Now, if it describes Jesus in Revelations is having hair like lamb's wool and feet like burnished brass. It's, you know, brass has been burnt in oven, right? So it gives a black Jesus in your mind, doesn't it? Just by what you read. But how is that possible? And you have the white Jews that is ruling. So it would have you to believe that it was white Jews in ancient times, doesn't it? Doesn't it? Just like that. That's how they got you deceived. And then they say, you know, you shall be my My disciples indeed, and you should know the truth, and truth should make you free. What did they say to him in John 8:32? They said, they laughed at him. They said, how can we be made free when we have not been in bondage to any man? Whoa. If these wasn't the people that was of Akhenaten and the one God, that God would have to lead them out and give them a whole new law, a whole new culture, and then deputize them to be reformers of this world, and then they is to be going into every corner of this earth and teaching the good news to everybody that God has come, and what he has come to do is make us all reformers and to transform these modern nations into the kingdom of God on earth. That's the gospel. That's the gospel. So they have it as that the Jew is white. Now, if the Jew is white and Jesus is black, that's going to set up this war. It's a war between the black Jews and the white Jews, because the black Jews are like, no, this is my stuff. But when you look at of Judaism, that's in Europe. It's not in the Middle East. So then that means that the Hebrew Israelites and the black Jews, they've been deceived. Then when you look up their oldest Haggadah, that's for the Passover, right? That's for the Passover, that little booklet of the Passover. The oldest one is where? In Europe. Then if you look at the Passover Seder plate, right? Look at the items that's on that Seder plate, right? You notice something on there that's not native to Egypt. That's not native to Ethiopia. That's not native to any Middle Eastern country around there, right? If the Jews was in Egypt and then they had their exodus out of there and they went into the Canaanite area and began to establish, then you're going to find out that the Habarus did that. Now you can find them in the writing of the letters, the Amarna letters. They're in the Amarna letters. That's the first time where the Hebrews or the Habarus was mentioned in world history. You see, not in the Bible. And it never called them Israelites. It called them Hebrews. Because they are a mixture of the Egyptian and Ethiopian Nubian women. You know what I mean? Those women, those dark-skinned women, right? Or melanated women. And when the Hyksos was there, right, they raped those women. And when they was finally expelled out, no damn exodus, when they was finally expelled out of there, they left their offspring, and the offspring that they made from those melanated women was the Habarus, the Hebrew. Akhenaten took them in, and they helped him to build the city of the one God in Egypt. That's the city of Amarna. All of this is accurate history that cannot be denied. It cannot be denied. You can't use the Bible as it is. You can't use it as it is, because it always is going to keep you in this time warp that you and some European Jews have this battle, but God has to come and settle the score. No, God don't have to come and settle the score. All you have to do is just listen to your brother right here, because your brother is telling you, you can put the stop on them right now. Stop. Get out of their damn religion. That's all you have to do. Now, but the Jew, he thinks he's smart, right? He thinks he's real smart. So white Jew thinks going on right there in the Bible. And the Hebrews are like always point out how we black, see, because Moses, he was black when he put his arm into his bosom and all that kind of stuff. And then they go into like how Solomon looked, oh, I'm black but comely, oh, ye daughters of Jerusalem, and all that's well and fine. But the European Jew still rules over Judaism. He controls the books, he controls the rituals, he controls Jerusalem. He's in control over that religion, right or wrong. You know that's right. You know that's right. You ain't in control of a goddamn thing. So let's stop it. Now, you got to figure out, wait, how am I not in control if this is my stuff? It's not your stuff. That's why you're not in control of it. They have invented a fraudulent history, a fraudulent religion. And with the printing press, they printed history books, they went back and edited things, and now when you buy books, ancient books, right, you see the copyright. And then you see that when this was reprinted, when this had to be translated, so what you're doing is trusting them. The hell are you trusting them, and then they doing this global enslavement and stuff like this. Only people that you can trust are the people that wasn't colonized, the people that wasn't invaded, the people that wasn't conquered. And that's the Ethiopian people. If you black or melanated, you better get your ass back down up in Ethiopia and learn something. You got to start fresh. You got to give up this lie. You got to give up this lie. Now, so you got that going on. Now, the Arabs, for them to keep the secret, the Jew says, fine. We got to add them up in there. The Jew helps the Eurasian Arab write his book called the Quran. Then they added more schisms to it. They said, whoa, you know, the prophets do no harm. You know what I mean? They're like sinless. They don't do anything, you know, because they're chosen by God and all those other kinds of things, right? So then they rewrite some of the biblical characters, the main ones anyway, right? And then they give all kinds of lofty titles and so on and so forth. And then they append their own belief system of taking many things from the city of Amarna. All things you're dealing with, thus saith the Lord, and what gives those religions palatable, to make them palatable, they stole it out of the city of Amarna, the first city in the world where people from all around the world made pilgrimages to. Was the city of Amarna. The first time in human history where every average, everyday people was able to go inside of temples to worship. And from that time, then all temples was open up to people. Where was that done at? The city of Amarna. This, what I'm telling you, is world history. They don't want you to know about Akhenaten. That is the Kadesh. That is the Messiah. That is the Mahdi. That is God. Him and his wife together, a pair. God bestowed power by the universal creator that came down on this earth, pressed the reset button, and got everybody all over the world talking about there is no God but the one. So then, that's why you can find that in the boundary stellar that predates the Bible. You can find it on the boundary stellar right now at the city of Amarna. The boundary stellar says that there is no God but the one, and Akhenaten is his son. Then he mentions Nefertiti, because those three are one. The universal creator, our father Akhenaten, and our mother Nefertiti. The European Jews, the European Christians, and the Eurasian Arabs has posed a fraud on the world. This is not their stuff. Their prayer formation that you see, that a lot of stuff got incorporated into the Coptic and then into the Roman Catholic Church. Where you find that at? The city of Amarna. You can see the Muslim in their prayer formations and so on and so forth praying just like the daughters of Akhenaten. When you look at the statues in the Cairo Museum. Wait, what? Oh, yeah. Then you got... Remember I just told you about the boundary stellar and what Akhenaten says right there, right? That's why you have in Deuteronomy 6:4 where it says, Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. This is why you find in the book of John where Jesus is praying before he gets killed, right? Supposedly, right? Because you know there was no Jesus born 2,000 years ago. So when it says, when they have it on his lips, that he praying, he said that there is no God but the one. And Jesus Christ is his son. So Jesus Christ is going to say that Jesus Christ is his son. This is how they got y'all. This is how they got you. And you just reading that, you like, oh, okay. So he's going to refer to himself in the third person like that? Do you know how insane he would have to be? Okay. All right. Okay. Maybe you didn't get that one. Okay. So then. That's why then they have it. Not in the Quran, but the first time the Shahada is mentioned in world history was when it was written on the Dome of the Rock at Jerusalem. Where it says there was no God but the one. Then later on, then they add, and Muhammad is his message. Uh-oh. See, when the Arab came in, they were looking for three things. In the words of John Henry Clark, right? They was looking for three things: gold and glory, and found all three. They sure did. Gold, God, and glory. Now, how about Islam? You go and you study about Bilal, the Ethiopian, right? The first caller to prayer, the first Adan, right? Muezzin, you know, that for Muhammad, right? Because he was Muhammad's slave at one time. Literal slave. So that means then those people had slaves. Don't think that they don't have slaves. Now, Bilal was holier than Muhammad. Just go back and look at Bilal, man. Go back and look at Bilal, man. This is why Muhammad says, and they have it in his writings, that he saw Bilal going into paradise. He heard his footsteps going into paradise before he is. Where did Bilal the Ethiopian learn about prostrating to the universal God, the one true God? He learned that down in Ethiopia. Why? Because after when the Egyptians messed up, and if this is after Akhenaten's ascension, after they pressed the reset button and then had everything going, after Akhenaten went through 4,100 miles of Egypt and he destroyed all the idols in Egypt and he set them back up as having one God again, and everywhere that Egypt has any kind of connection throughout the world, everybody knew that there was one God right now, and that was from the God King Akhenaten. He reestablished that. He reestablished that. And when he reset, he reset it forever. And then he incorporated that into cultures, into languages, into politics, into economics. This is why you have fair trade and balances and so on and so forth. This is why you have peace treaties and so on and so forth. Why? That comes out of the 18th dynastic period. You got to go back and you got to research. You got to know why this is happening. Then Akhenaten advanced civilization. How did he advance civilization? See, you remember back then that it used to take the Egyptians like 20, 30 years to build a city and so on and so forth, because they had to carve out those big rocks. But Akhenaten said, oh no, that's not what we're going to do. That's not what we're going to do. So he invented a technology called the teletot. And teletot means two arms or two hands width, right? Easily carry the blocks. So he designed this technique where they would chisel out the blocks, right? About arm's width, right? So that your fingertips to your elbow, right? And then they will be able to construct buildings quicker. And from there, then he built the city of Amarna, the only city in known history that is dedicated to the universal creator, the one God. Mecca wasn't designed for the universal creator. Neither was Jerusalem, and neither was Vatican City. It's only the city of Amarna. And anything that I'm saying to you, I give $1 million reward for anybody that can refute anything that I'm saying. You better come with the purse, because I'm taking that. So don't think you're going to come and then don't be able to pay. Right? So that's my challenge. Before you come, you make sure you have that money, because I'm taking it. I'm taking it. I'll take all properties you have too. Put that up too. I'm that sure about this truth. Now, so for the first time in human history, we built this city. He built an ultra-modern city. Egypt hated it because they survived off polytheism. They survived off the worship of Pharaoh, but Akhenaten threw all that off. He said, you don't prostrate to me. No, you prostrate to our Father, which art in heaven. Wait, what do you mean? Out of the sun, this, because without the sun, we can't survive. We can't survive. If the light of the sun goes out, your scientist tells you that within 72 hours, all life form would cease to exist. It would be utter chaos, the known universe, if the light of the sun ever goes out. The planets can't even hold up if we would go. We don't know. That's how important the sun is. It gives us life. It sustains us. It's the physical representation of the light, the wisdom, the love, and the light of God, always bestowing its rays upon its creation. Oh, Lord, have mercy. That's beautiful. That's beautiful. So, Akhenaten built this ultra-modern city, right? This ultra-modern city that you wouldn't even be able to take a shower today or flush your toilet had not been for Akhenaten and his invention. You would never have a bottle of perfume. And it's all kinds of inventions that they did in the 18th dynastic period and at Amarna that you have no clue about that you're using today. That's the importance of Akhenaten. That's what they don't want you to know. That's what they don't want you to know. So from out of the Old Testament into the New Testament, you see how they got this Jew wife. Then you go and transfer that. Then you talk to Paul. Then he says that Jesus said that salvation is of the Jews, right? The Jew ain't you. It ain't you, melanated people. It's the Jews. You ain't the original Jew. You the original Hebrew or the Hebrew. That's the ones that chosen. So really, salvation is of the Hebrews. It was them that was chosen to do something. Amongst the whole group. They wasn't chosen by themselves. They just part of the cultural groups. You see? So now, Now, with that said, you go into Paul. Paul was invented to transfer, because like you see, all the disciples, they couldn't keep the word of God, right? Jesus had gave them instructions, but they didn't want the Gentiles to come in. So now Paul becomes the light of the Gentiles, right? He becomes to make sure that the gospel is now bestowed upon the Gentiles. How they do that? Well, then there's a scripture that says that it says it just like this: the kingdom of God is taken from you and given unto another people that will bring forth the fruits thereof. Then all the disciples was disqualified. Then you get Paul the apostle, and Paul the apostle, his mission was to who? Was to the Gentiles. Once when salvation goes over to the Gentiles, meaning the seat of power, the seat of authority, right? The ecclesiastical powers, right? All that means then ain't nothing of any melanated people. They have nothing to say anymore if all that is transferred to Europe. And part of that is transferred, right, to their own kith and kin, which is the Eurasian people. And this is how you got Mohammed coming up in there. Because now, the kingdom of God, since it's been taken by force, and the kingdom of God, since you won't do right, now the kingdom is taken from you and being given unto another people that will bring forth the fruits thereof. Now, according to their books, it's transferred to the Gentiles and to the Eurasians. And now that's how they got power. To the Jew first, then to the Gentile. The Jew is European. The Gentile is Eurasian. This is how they did it. You got to get a grip. This is how they did it. And then they came up with this fallacious chronology of Shem, Japheth, and Ham. And they got us as Ham, the alchemical people, right? I thought we're not supposed to eat Ham. So they label you Ham, right? Okay, fine. Then they have Ham as doing all kinds of nasty things, right? He uncovered the nakedness of Noah, and then Ham was cursed, right? He cursed his son, you know, Canaan, right? So the Canaanites is cursed. So that means then that the blacks is cursed. This is why the Hebrew Israelites can go all the way over to Israel, and the Ethiopian Jew can leave Ethiopia and go over there and then try to take Israeli citizenship. This is why they're cursed. This is why when you look into classical Islam, Iblis, the devil, right? And the jinn, what color are they? Black. Then you look in older Bible dictionaries and so on and so forth, and Bibles that have pictorial history. What color was the devil? He was black. Satan was black. You see? So blacks get denigrated all over the world. See, because it's from the Jew first to the Gentile. You are not included. They kept you out of the family of God. But really, they never was in the family. They were supposed to be reformed by us doing the reforming. We have lost our way, and it's time that we come home. You have to get culturally re-educated into these teachings. You have to become regrounded with your own people. This is why we're sitting here in North America as black. We have no country. We have no flag of a country. We have no cuisine that connects to a country. We have no history that connects to a country. Even our broken language, nobody wants it. But all we have to do is accept who and what we are as the Amarnian people that disobeyed the Lord of glory. And all we have to do is follow that prescription in 2 Chronicles 7:14. And when you get done with that, then you need to head over here, and then you need to learn everything you can, because the real flag that we should be waving is the conquering Lion of Judah flag of Ethiopia. We should be putting down the soul food and picking up the Ethiopian cuisine. We should put down, you know, even though we have to live here in the Americas, right? We have to master English. I want you to put down English. I want you to master English. And then you have to adopt your original language of Amharic. You have to put down Islam, Christianity, and Judaism that is in control over by the white Arabs, the pale Arabs, or the white Jews and the white Christians. And you have to pick up the original Christianity, the original Islam, the original, if you're going to call it Judaism or Hebrew, that's in Ethiopia. All the original stuff is in Ethiopia, beloved. We got our own calendar. We got our own way of telling time. We got our own calendar. We got our own everything. You don't even have to go under the Gregorian calendar no more. That attaches back into ancient biblical times, coming all the way down to today. So what they thought, that they was going to cut off your history. No, your history is still being kept for you. All you have to do is claim what's yours. How could you claim that? Because they called you black. They denigrated you because of that. Then they called you nigger. But nigger was just another word, right? In a denigrated form. But the true word to that is nigas. The nigas is king in Ethiopia. You see? You really king. But when they denigrated you, you became the nigga. You see? Man, you better think about this real quick. Then they called you black. Why are they calling you black? Because Ethiopia means burnt skin. Burnt skin. Or those that has been kissed by the sun. What we kiss with? We kiss with melanin. Man, I do this, man. This is us. So our history back there. That's our mother country. So you can live here and then claim that. You could be dual citizens. There's nothing wrong with that. But your citizenship should be over there. So in case anything happens, you know, into America, you got your homeland, just like the Mexicans got their homeland and their flag and everything that belongs to them and their culture and their cuisine. Ethiopia has all that for us. All we have to do is come home. And in the words of my uncle, His Imperial Majesty Haile Selassie, the great emperor of Ethiopia, this is what he said. He said, not only is he king over all dark peoples everywhere, he said that includes the Negro in America. So what that means for you, that means he just claimed for you to accept your own people, accept what belongs to you as the prodigal son. Read that story of the prodigal son. See, you've been cut off from your parts. And then in Ezekiel 37, that's talking about you. Now you have to be reconnected. You have to be reconnected unto your own people. That's the only way you're going to survive it. To the Jew first, then to the Gentiles.